Hello everyone, how are you going? And welcome back to Lifehacks, a place that we should really just be coming more often because every time we come here, we just get amazing tips just to be able to cruise through life. But anyway, let's jump straight into it, shall we? So then, starting right off with moving attached hardware furniture like this. Oh yeah, it definitely works, but that's the thing with Lifehacks. I always feel as though, I don't know, some of these posts are just not really Lifehacks or just some more things that are just more, I don't know, common knowledge, but obviously not. Because I would have thought that doing something like this just makes so much sense. You know, if you buy a furniture, it just often comes like that, or maybe obviously it's in a bag and a box or something. But either way, it is generally just kind of cling wrap. There's something attached to the piece of furniture. And so to be able to do it at home with cling wraps definitely makes sense, but I never would have thought of that as a life hack. I mean, it might be a little bit difficult in the first place to be able to wrap them up without them falling all over the place, and so maybe you want to put it in some kind of bag and then screw it to the furniture. I don't even know what you could do, but there obviously this is definitely not the only way, but it's definitely a good way. And I guess while we're on the topic, in addition to just kind of storing them in a nice, easy, safe place, at the same time, if you can put them exactly back in where they came from, that is the absolute ultimate goal, because then you know exactly where they came from. You take it out, you put it straight back in, it never gets lost. I mean, in saying that, and I'm just trying to think if there's a more environmentally friendly way to be doing it, because obviously you don't just want to be wasting a whole bunch of cling wrap just kind of tying up bolts, and so maybe you could use some newspaper and then just do one kind of wrap of tape and that would be a little bit better. I really don't know, but either way, I have to give this life hack some brownie points because it just makes so much sense. And the amount of people that just lose stuff on just bolts, screws, whatever it may be, when really it's that simple, it's just ridiculous. Well, hey, if you wanted to know what it feels like to go even further beyond, really the absolute top tier goal is just to keep the tool there as well. You know, like let's say you need a 6mm Allen key, just put it in there as well. Then you will have everything you need. You're not going to search for stuff and go, oh, I just wish I had this. And when you have finally finished the entire day of moving, you just want to sleep and you got a bed frame that you have to quickly put together. Really, you're not going to just be wasting time and just getting furious with yourself because you lost a little bit. And so yeah, definitely a life hack in that regard, I guess. The smart way to mow the lawn. Don't tell me. Yes, it is. Oh my goodness. This is just such a classic. Whether you do it with a post in the ground, whether you do it rather hills, hoys, or whatever it may be, it makes so much sense. I mean, I guess you do have to kind of have a self-driving or assisted lawnmower to be able to do this, but the entire thing just looks so cool. I mean, it's been in every ad ever for lawn mowing. And to be honest, I cannot blame it one bit, really. I guess you can kind of vary the speed or how quickly it does the entire lawn by the circumference of whatever you're putting the tire around or just whatever it may be. And then, of course, you have all the usual lawn mowing things like height and speed and all those kind of things. But really, I don't see a bucket catchment on this. So I don't really know what's happening to all the clippings. I mean, from the 23 pixels that surround the lawnmower at any one time, it looks as though it's just kind of shoving it inwards. And so maybe it just continually has to kind of chop it up and just, I don't know, mulch it into the middle. And I don't really get why that would make sense, because by the end, that lawnmower is going to be pushing so much grass around the poor thing. But hey, what can I say? At the moment, it is certainly just a little lawnmower that could, and look at it go round and round and round and round. It is honestly just a little bit oddly satisfying, as well as just being a life hack. It's just satisfying because, as this post so beautifully demonstrates, really you just make one quick tie in the middle, give the lawnmower a push, and off it goes. There you go, the lawn has been mowed. I mean, I guess it would probably be recommended to stay and watch it, because I don't really know how the end works. Does it just keep winding itself on? Especially if you've got an automatic driver, I have no idea how that works. But hey, that is definitely above my pay grade. I've never done this, but it just looks cool. And I guess on top of everything else, if you actually just want kind of a funky pattern in your grass, this is probably one way to do it. You know, you don't have to do a full crisscross. No, you just quickly attach a rope to a post and then the lawnmower, and you get a brilliant spiral. Honestly, I don't know how else they do crop circles, because this would just make the perfect sense to be able to do that. And so look, I guess in order to be a life hack, it doesn't have to be anything revolutionary. It just has to be a big brain maneuver, or if nothing else, just a work smarter, not harder. This is super helpful for birthday parties and cookouts. Oh yeah, I can get behind that idea. At first I was going, what am I looking at? But no, a fitted sheet over a table just as a tablecloth. I mean, I guess if you wanted to put a piece of ply down on the table, you could probably treat it as an ironing board as well. But no, it makes so much sense. I mean, once you've got a whole bunch of things on the table, generally the tablecloth doesn't really move unless you got little kids just pulling and yanking on it. But I feel as though if that's the case, then there isn't a fitted sheet alive that is going to stop that from happening. I mean, obviously it's just a single, but I wonder if there's a particular single. Like, you know, there's different sizes between every bed size, and so I wonder if there's one in particular that just works absolutely perfectly. And also, if nothing else, just the range of patterns and fabrics that bed sheets come in, it just is going to allow for so many options, really. Obviously, with tablecloths, it's generally like, I don't know, party hats or gray, or I don't even know, I guess a fluoro one. Whereas when you use a fitted sheet, you have every single color, as we can see here, just a brilliant orange, or really you could put teddy bears or anything really on there. It'd be quite cool, which would certainly just offer up so many more options. You know, if you're trying to do a themed birthday party, you're just struggling to find any kind of decorations for a party, then really, I'm sure if you actually looked hard enough, you'd be able to find a bed sheet in anything you could ever need. So I guess exactly like the last one, it doesn't have to be revolutionary. It doesn't have to do anything like that. I mean, I guess if you don't like the look of trestle table legs, you might have to look for a different option, because this is definitely not going to be the way to go if that's the case. And I guess the only other thing to consider is you probably don't want to use your bed sheets, you know, like maybe just use the old ones and go out and buy some ones that are just nice and cheap, and you go, I don't care what happens to them, because there is definitely going to be some drinks and food and everything spilled all over them eventually. But otherwise I can't fault it, because really it looks incredible. I never thought I'd need a fitted sheet on a trestle table, really just hospital quarters basically is what's going on there, but it definitely is nice to know. Don't let them go to waste. We're talking about mulberries, are we? Okay, I had no idea what we were going to not be letting go go to waste. But yes, that definitely makes sense, because those mulberry bushes can be mean, you know, they're just covered in spikes, and really they're just so clustered, you just, everywhere you go, you just go, oh, I'm just getting stabbed. And I mean, I guess looking at the mulberries and how poisonous they kind of look, it makes sense that the whole tree wants to be trying to kill you. But no, this person has managed a way to kind of beat nature and go, hi, you know what, I want my mulberries and I'm going to get them whether you want me to or not, because there is a serious amount of fruit in this tree. I mean, I've seen the mulberry bushes before, but I've never seen one with that kind of just absolute quantity that it's got here. I mean, I guess when I think about it, it kind of makes sense that the mulberry bush does have spikes on it, because, well, really, obviously, it's not a poisonous fruit, or I imagine it's not a poisonous fruit for virtually every animal. And so when you have something appetizing like that, you definitely want to try and protect yourself to be able to grow in the first place. And I guess if nothing else, considering the mulberries are edible and the rest of the tree is covered in spikes, it kind of makes sense, you know, eat the sacrificial lambs, if nothing else. And so look, even though this contraption is definitely the most janky life hack we've seen so far, and really, we saw a lawnmower just so attached with a piece of rope, at the same time, I have to give them credit, because like the title said, don't let them go to waste. You know, you can go to the shops and buy them, or you can just kind of strap a bottle to the end of the pole and just kind of pick them off yourself. I definitely know which one is definitely going to be better for the pocket and the wallet. You know, like I said, and like we can see, when you get a decent mulberry bush, there is just so many. And so when you actually see it like this, you go, man, they are charging you so much for such a little product in the end. And if you don't collect them, what are they going to do? Just fall onto the ground with a million other ones and rot away. Like, really, that's just such a waste of the tree's potential and energy in the first place. So look, I guess if you've got a mulberry tree, or really just any fruit tree that you don't know, I'm not dealing with those spikes, then here you go. Here is your life hack to just be able to get free unlimited fruit for free. It is that simple. I mean, it only costs a bottle, I guess. How to take an egg from a hen. Oh, what the hell? This is going to look so weird. It's just going to suddenly emerge with an egg. Oh, wait. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, I can certainly understand, because that hen does not want to let that egg go. Look at this. Whoa, there's two eggs under there at least. What the hell is going on there? Jeez, I guess it makes sense, because they're so light and really they're kind of just covering it but not actually sitting on it. But no, all for the low, low price of just getting your fingers pecked out a couple of times. I mean, really, it's just a brilliant trade if you ask me. I mean, I must admit, I don't really understand the entire thing, because don't you just usually wait for the chicken to leave and then you just collect the eggs then? Like, the entire situation seems a little bit backwards here, unless this chicken just isn't leaving for whatever reason. That could easily be the case, because I am by no means an expert in chickens, but yeah, I just would always thought you kind of just wait and then you go, oh, look, there's two eggs there, no chicken, no nothing. I mean, in saying that, I certainly don't blame the chicken for being a little bit protective over its eggs, because it's kind of the entire idea, you know, the chicken and the egg, the mother hen situation, the, all of it just refers to this exact situation happening. And so even though in this circumstance, it definitely makes it a little bit more annoying to get the eggs, and you go, man, I just want an omelette, I just want bacon and eggs, whatever it may be, you're just going, I want these eggs, and really, this chicken, it's just in the way, time to break out the ladle, or whatever this is, or maybe it's a pasta scoop, because I guess in the scheme of things, the life hack works brilliantly, you don't get pecked too much, obviously it pecks the handle a couple of times, or maybe your hand once, but once it is in there, you just have a nice, easy full tab, you just remove them from under the chicken, no one gets hurt, no one gets injured, the entire thing just works really well. And so look, I guess I have to commend this person for sharing their life hack, because I can only imagine that they went through a little bit of pain and just trials and tribulation to be able to figure this one out. You know, how many times did they get pecked and just not get their omelette before they realized, oh, I guess I can actually just do it this way. Verbal jujitsu to avoid a fight. Jeez, this is only going to be a little bit of a change from a chicken, but here you go, I'm going to have to bring it. They go outside, the guy throws a punch and ducks. Okay, that's certainly not a good situation, but he's describing a fight. He's not actually, this isn't a fight, you dream. He's just seeing it by a sentence, 6 years in prison. Wow, that is certainly an escalation of events. So here we go, I want to see where this guy is going with this entire thing. Here we go, what the hell are you doing? Oh yeah, I can certainly understand how that would work. That shirt, man, yeah, look at that. Oh wow, okay, I guess it makes sense. If you need a lie to get out of a fight, it definitely makes sense to do that. But that's just a little bit extreme, isn't it? But no, everything that he just said made so much sense. I mean, I imagine that I cut it down a little bit, but really, he was just kind of talking about how to not get into the fight. I mean, the entire thing is just set talking to a whole bundle of jujitsu students, but really, like he says, verbal jujitsu just saves you from actually just taking the fight outside or anywhere else. Like he said, there is a whole bundle of guys out there that go out there, they train jujitsu, and they go, okay, cool, I'm now kind of proficient and know what I'm doing. And then one day, however it happens, they end up in a fight and they end up causing some serious damage. Obviously, none of these guys ever meant for it to happen. I imagine the guy in the story that he was telling about the guy, he actually just hit him and then he ended up going to jail for manslaughter, because the entire situation just escalated way above what it was ever meant to be. And so I guess what this guy's talking about is just, sure, go out and train and do what you think, be confident in yourself, but at the same time just avoid those situations in the first place. Just avoid escalating the situation to the point where you have to use your fist, where really the entire thing could have been solved by just kind of saying, oh, you know, what's your problem, oh, I don't know, I just lost my dad, and just like lie, what doesn't matter, whatever it is, just get out of that situation in the first place. So really, it just makes so much sense. If you were actually going out there to train boxing, jujitsu, any kind of martial art, if you were training your body in that martial art just for self-defense, then really, why not also train your tongue just to be able to avoid the entire situation? Like, really, the amount of fights that could probably be avoided just by taking this guy's teaching, well, it would be ridiculous. Because look, the examples that he's giving might be the most cliche ones in the world, but really, that's just what happens, you know? These people that are just drunk, they do stupid things, and they just start saying random things, and they get offended, whatever, it doesn't even matter, they're just idiots. But usually, if people are talking like that, they're actually looking looking for a fight. And then so for you to give it to them, well, you kind of just gave them what they want. And then really the entire thing escalated. You might get hurt. They might get hurt. Whatever it may be, you might get charged. There are just too many wrong things to be dealing with. And so, yeah, this entire thing is definitely just a life hack. I mean, I never would have expected it to be on this life hack. Like I said, to go from a chicken with a ladle and then suddenly to this is definitely just a juxtaposition. But I have to give it to this guy. It's just a very simple message. Avoid the fight. Stop trying to fight people that you shouldn't be fighting. Just absolutely de-escalate the entire situation and everyone will be better for it. Fixing a zipper with a fork. And then we go back to a fork. Anyway, let's just see what this is going to have. All right, what are we going to have? Oh, okay, so when your thing actually comes off, how does that work? I can't actually remember how a zipper mechanism works in terms of how that would work, but obviously it does. And just incredibly well at that, like it just absolutely slides on. I mean, I can only imagine that you probably have to line them up pretty well. But clearly, if you're able to get everything aligned, it just flows on. I mean, I don't really know how they've secured the fork there because I can only imagine it takes a little bit of force to do. And also, I can only assume that there is a very particular kind of, I don't know what to call it, width between each prong of the fork that would work the best. And so I guess you certainly have to hope that you have the right size fork for your zipper, but no, like I said, it just clearly works quite well, doesn't it? And see, I can definitely understand why something like this is towards the top of the month, you know, compared to, I don't know, a chicken ladle, it definitely makes sense. So there's a lot more people that are going to be experiencing a problem like this compared to a chicken. And so even though I feel as though it is quite rare for that to happen with the zipper, you know, doesn't it usually just get jammed or come off one side, or I don't really know, but I've never really seen it just a loose zipper like that. I guess at the same time, it is just so cheap and easy, and really anyone would be able to do it if it works that well, that it makes sense to just kind of keep it in the back of your mind. And also, as well as just obviously being able to implement this into your own life, I reckon you could actually just be someone's hero, you know? If someone had a zipper that fell off their favorite jacket or their favorite, I don't know, bag or whatever it may be, you're gonna say, oh, I know how to fix it for you, you know? I just kind of whip out the fork and then there you go, all of a sudden it's fixed. And so in comparison to the other ones where even though I guess you could kind of share the message and that's all good, this one is definitely just one where you go, oh, I have the power to fix zippers and no one else does. So, I mean, of course, when I say no one, I mean no one that has seen this post before, but it really would allow you to become such a magician that I'm kind of surprised that this thing is being shared. You know, usually magic tricks are kind of kept under wraps in a hush-hush environment. And so for someone to be sharing this wizardry is kind of just unheard of, but I guess I'll take it. And so I guess it really can be just a very simple things like fixing a zipper that just make people day or just become life hacks. I mean, I guess I might just add, make sure you put it on the right side, because you certainly wouldn't want it to just glide on so easily like they show in the video just to be out of knocking it off again because you put it on the wrong side. And so look, I guess his life hack comes with a little dab of just common sense, but other than that, it just makes sense. And so now finally for the top of the month for life hacks, we have what a smart idea. What's going to be the smart idea? Is that a watermelon? Hang on a second. What is going on here? Whoa, okay. Oh, medicine watermelon. Yes, okay. I can certainly understand why that works. I mean, I can only assume that it works up into a particular age group because after a while they'll be going, what is this watermelon? This watermelon doesn't taste like the last watermelon, so I don't understand what is going on here. But it obviously seems to work quite well here. I mean, I must admit, it kind of looks like Coke. And so even though I have no idea how real this entire video is, I guess the idea and the concept makes sense and would probably work. I mean, I also feel as though if you really do want to cement the idea, you should definitely just use a secondary sword that you gave yourself to kind of use. Like, you actually just create that bond then. And then on top of that, I feel as though the child would just be way less sus about the weird tasting watermelon. And you also would have to be quite careful about where you put the kid and how you put it down so you don't just knock it over and they say, hang on, what's this shot glass of medicine all of a sudden? But other than that, I guess the entire idea is just flawless. There's nothing wrong with it. And I guess that's why the top of the month for life hacks. But no, hey, the entire video is just a cute little idea, regardless of whether it's real or fake or works or not. You know, that's up to the parents to actually be able to execute on them. But either way, like I said, the idea actually seems pretty cool. You can actually just enjoy a little bit of watermelon yourself. And then of course, on top of everything else, after you actually just get the medicine down the hatch, then you can actually just bring out a knife and chop up the watermelon and then enjoy some of that as well. So really, it's just a win-win-win-win situation. I mean, I guess that is definitely just assuming that the kid actually still knows what real watermelon tastes like and doesn't hate it. I mean, I can only imagine that considering that they brought it out in a watermelon, you'd probably know what the kid likes. And I guess you could just kind of transfer it across watermelon, pineapple, rock melon. I don't know. There's a million different fruits out there. Do whatever you want. But as well as just being able to get the medicine to them, just make sure that you balance it between actually just not destroying the original taste and actually making them just hate their whatever fruit it is. Because to be honest, I feel as though fruit can be sometimes just as vital as medicine can be. I mean, obviously not in a like-for-like situation, but really fruit is just yummy and good for you. And so, hey, I guess if you can increase the amount of fruit that your kid's eating and give them their medicine, then that's just an absolute win and life hack all in one. But anyway, that is going to do it for the top of the month for life hacks. So thank you for watching. If you did enjoy the video, feel free to do the YouTube algorithmic things down below. Let me know if you had a favorite post out of any of these. Other than that, we check out awesome posts all over Reddit, so make sure you check some of the other videos out now. Or hey, maybe you even just want to consider subscribing so that you don't miss another one of these in the future. But all in all, have a good one and see ya. We'll be right back.